Acts chapter 12, that's our reading for today. We've seen wonderful things happening. And in spite of persecution, the kingdom is growing and the gospel has been taken to the Gentiles and Jews alike. In Antioch, we've seen Jews and Greeks obeying the gospel, even Gentiles sending relief to their Jewish brethren in light of the famine. So really good things happening. And as Barnabas would note in Antioch, he saw God's grace on display in these brethren. But then we get to our reading today, and God's people are, well, they're going to go through some really hard things. They're going to experience some loss by way of this physical earth. But I want us to appreciate their response. You're familiar with this chapter because we reference it often. So let's read together, and then I'll leave you with just a couple of really straightforward things to think about this morning. Acts chapter 12, let's read the entire chapter. It's a lengthy reading, so I hope you'll hang with me. Acts chapter 12, let's begin reading at verse 1. It says, "Now about that time, Herod the king laid hands on some who belonged to the church in order to mistreat them. And he had James, the brother John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread. And when he had seized him, he put him in prison, delivering him to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending, after the Passover, to bring him out before the people. So Peter was kept in prison, but prayer for him was being made fervently by the church of God, the church to God. On the very night when Herod was about to bring him forward, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and guards in front of the door were watching over the prison. And behold, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared, and the light shone in the cell, and he struck Peter's side and woke him up, saying, 'Get up quickly.' And his chains fell off his hands. And the angel said to him, 'Gird yourself and put on your sandals.' And he did so. And he said to him, 'Wrap your cloak around you and follow me.' And he went out and continued to follow, and he did not know what was being done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they had passed the first and second guard, they came to the iron gate that leads into the city, which opened for them by itself. And they went out, went along one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. When Peter came to himself, he said, 'Now I know for sure that the Lord has sent forth his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all that all the Jewish people were expecting.' And when he had realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who was also called Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. When he knocked at the door of the gate, a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer. And when she recognized Peter's voice because of her joy, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter was standing in front of the gate. And they said to her, 'You are out of your mind.' She kept insisting that it was so. They kept saying, 'It is his angel.' But Peter continued knocking, and when they had opened the door, they saw him and were amazed. But motioning to them with his hand to be silent, he described to them how the Lord had led him out of the prison, and he said, 'Report these things to James and the brethren.' And he left and went to another place. Now when day came, there was no small disturbance among the soldiers as to what could have happened, or what could have become of Peter. When Herod had searched for him and had not found him, he examined the guards and ordered that they be led away to execution. Then he went down from Judea to Caesarea and was spending time there." Verse 20 says, "Now he was very angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon. One accord, they came to him, and having won over Blastus, the king's chamberlain, they were asking for peace because their country was fed by the king's country. And on an appointed day, Herod, having put on his royal apparel, took his seat on the rostrum and began delivering an address to them. The people kept crying out, 'The voice of God and not of a man.' And immediately an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give God the glory, and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of the Lord continued to grow and to be multiplied, and Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem, and they had fulfilled their mission, taking along with them John, who was also called Mark." You know, this chapter begins with really kind of a tough passage to read. It tells us that Herod, the king, he laid hands on some of the brethren intending to do harm. And then it tells us that James, the brother of John, that he was put to death by the sword. James, an apostle. You know, you could only imagine the shockwaves that this must have sent throughout the kingdom. One of their leaders. You know, you can't help but be reminded when you read this of that time in Matthew chapter 20 when James and John's mother approaches Jesus and she requests that her sons be seated at Jesus' right and left hand in the kingdom. And you remember there in Matthew 28, verse 22, how Jesus would respond. He would say, you don't know what you're asking. Jesus said to them, can you drink the cup I'm going to drink? We can, they answered. Verse 23, Jesus said to them, you will indeed drink from my cup. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those whom they have been prepared by my Father. James would be the first of the apostles to give his life for the cause of Christ. He'd be killed by this tyrannical leader, Herod, with the sword. So Herod sees all of this and finds a favor with some of the people. So he has Peter arrested as well. This time, to ensure he doesn't escape, he surrounds him with four squads of four guards, it says. And there's chains. You know, if you're the people of God, maybe a new convert, you know, things are getting rather intense, right? They're getting real. It's getting really close to home, and now they're murdering even our Lord's chosen men. Maybe now would be a time to get out, right, to cut your losses. How would these brethren respond to this? I love verse 5. It says, so Peter was kept in prison. Listen to this. But the church was earnestly praying to God for him. People of God were praying to God for Peter. They prayed. Brethren, we must devote ourselves to prayer. We must pray for one another. God moved. Long story short, as we just read, Peter, he's released from prison. And Peter's reaction to God's divine intervention in verse 11 says that Peter came to himself and said, now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen. Now look at verse 12. When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where, listen to this, where many people had gathered. What were they doing? It says they were praying. The people of God, on Peter's behalf, they gathered together at a house, and they prayed. They prayed for Peter. I want you to let that sink in. Brethren, I'm convinced we need to do more of this. We need to be more intentional about praying for one another. Even getting together and praying for one another. You love Rhoda's joy as she sees her brother and she runs back in, leaves Peter at the door, and she tells her brethren, they don't believe her. I'm not going to be hard on the brethren here. We probably would have had a similar response with all that they're going through. But all the while, Peter, he's still at the door and he's knocking. And as I'm reading this, you can almost picture, I get this picture in my mind of Peter looking through the glass in the door and seeing his brethren gathered and praying for him. He must have been overwhelmed with gratitude as he witnessed the love of his brethren, taking the time to come together and to pray on his behalf. You know, when you go through stuff, in this world, we all go through stuff. Many are going through a lot of stuff right now. We as a congregation have been through a lot this past year, these past so many months. You know, there is something so strengthening when you're going through stuff. To know that your brothers and sisters in Christ, to know that your brethren are praying for you. A lot of times there's not a whole lot else they can do for you, really. But just to know that they are praying to God on your behalf, to a God that cares and has the ability to meet your needs and to give you what you need, but also to just know that they love you that much, that they're willing to take their time and pray for you. You know, over the last 6 years, I think nearly every time I see my sister, Louise Stevenson, she always tells me how the night before, on Saturday, the night before the Lord's Day, how she has prayed for me and prayed for my family, how she always prays for the message that I will present on the Lord's Day. I have to tell you, every time she tells me, it gives me so much joy and strength. You know, to know that she loved me enough, loved my family enough, loved the kingdom enough, that she took the time to pray for me, pray for my family. So special. You know, our chapter ends with Herod's end. Verse 21. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, he sat on the throne and delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of a God, not of a man." Herod should have shut that down right then. Verse 23, immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down. And he was eaten by worms and he died. Here he is, in all his pomp and all his circumstance. And you've got these misguided people, and they're singing his praises, literally, as he addresses them. No doubt thinking he's in charge, right? No doubt emboldened by what had taken place with James. "This is the voice of a God, not a man," they shout. I have no doubt that Herod loved the sound of that and probably believed it. God knew his heart. And God moved. An angel of the Lord struck him down. He was eaten by worms and he died. Why? Very simple. He didn't give praise to God. He didn't glorify God. Two obvious takeaways, brethren, this morning. We must pray for one another. We must carve time out of our day for our brethren to pray to God on their behalf. We need to get in the habit of that. Amen. Let them know you're praying for them. I need to do better with that. And then number two, praise and always give God the glory. I love verse 24. It says, "But the word of God continued to spread and to flourish." No man can stop the plans of God. Let's remember that. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful for our time together. Father, we're thankful for the avenue of prayer, that we have the ability, just ordinary people, sinners, who have transgressed your will far too often, Father. But through your mercy, through your grace, through your Son, we can be forgiven of those sins. Be reconciled back to you, a relationship that allows us to address you as our Father, to bring our petitions, to offer our gratitude and praise, to ask for your power, often by way of healing of those who are sick, those who are struggling, those who are hurting. And Father, certainly we have those amongst us right now. Father, we continue to ask you to be with our brother Howard. We're so thankful for him. Please, God, give him the strength that he needs. Father, we ask you to be with Ellie as she so courageously fights, Father, for the progress that she has made, for the protection that you gave her during this virus, Father, we are most thankful. Be with Brandon, be with the girls. Father, be with all of our brethren who have been affected by this virus. If it be your will, Father, we continue to ask to rid us of this virus. But Father, your will be done. May we be content. You are so good to us, God, and we are so thankful. Father, bless us this day. Help us to be light. Help us to represent your Son to a lost and dying world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.